Today, we're going to do something conceptually a little bit more challenging. And I know that you love a challenge, so I'm sure that you're with me. And so we'll take it slow. We don't have huge amounts of content, so I'm very happy to go again and again and again over this until we make sure that we have it. Because what we are going to talk about today is mid-latitude cyclones. So we're going to go back and remind ourselves what cyclones are. But here, we are in the mid-latitudes. Sort of most of the US is in the mid-latitudes. And so really, these are the big weather systems that come our way. When we have those big winter storms, this is what we're actually encountering, these big mid-latitude cyclones moving off the Pacific. And so we're going to look in more detail about sort of how they form. And we're also going to start getting into the detail of why we get highs and lows in different places, okay? So, as a quick reminder, we have quiz 7 available as usual. It'll be available from 6 p.m. today until 11 a.m. on Tuesday as usual. Also, for those of you who have your midterms back, I uploaded the answer keys earlier this week. So do make sure that you take a look back. I know it's painful, but make sure that you have a look back and see what you missed. Was it a silly mistake, or is it something that conceptually you're not quite grasping? And if that's the case, then please do make an attempt to come and see the Chiesa or me. Okay, so let's launch straight in. So here I'm showing the fronts, the forecast, 5 days from now. So we're looking at Tuesday of next week. So next time we're having a lecture, this is what our atmosphere is going to look like. And you can see that what we're looking forward to this weekend and early next week is this movement of much cooler air. Today is the last day of the Santa Anas, which everyone's gonna be happy about, I'm sure. So tomorrow we're gonna get a little bit cooler, and then over the weekend, and especially as this cold front moves past us on Monday, Tuesday, we're gonna get cool, and we're gonna stay cool for at least sort of 2 or 3 days, okay? But you can see that we have a number of different things going on there, okay? We have this huge high pressure system out over the Pacific, and that's really quite typical for this time of year. We have these semi-permanent high-pressure cells. Remember, we don't get a nice consistent band of high pressure like our three-cell conceptual model says, but we do have this really pretty consistent area of high pressure sat out to the side of us. What do we have moving across Texas? Can everyone remember 2 days ago? What is that moving across Texas? A dry line, thank you, yes, it's a dry line. Do you remember that symbol? And is there a change in temperature as that dry line moves past somewhere? Is there a change in temperature? No, I would go with no, yep. So there's no change in temperature. What does change? The clue's in the name. The humidity changes as that dry line moves over, okay? We've already talked about the cold front. How do you know it's a cold front? It's coming close to us on Tuesday. It's blue, yes? Blue is cold, right? And it has those triangles on it, so if this was black and white, you'd still be able to tell. And that cold air is behind, it's further to the north. And where has that air been forming? It's been sat, forming just off Alaska, okay, south of the Aleutian Islands. So what characteristics would it have? Would it be maritime air or continental air? Maritime. Would it be tropical, polar, or Arctic? Polar, okay. So remember, we've got our air masses, and now we have those fronts between those air masses. Okay, so we're going to come back in detail to look at the sort of feature that we see very in the middle of the US there. You can see that we have a cold front on the left, a warm front joining up with it, and you can see an occluded front at the top where they join together. And we're going to talk today about those things, and those sort of three things together are what we call mid-latitude cyclones, okay? So why should you care? So this is a satellite image of a gigantic mid-latitude cyclone. And you can see this is enormous. This is from 1993 They called it the storm of the century. It still stands out as an enormous, enormous system. It affected 26 states. I think it killed several people because there was very heavy snowfall associated with this, especially to the north. There was even a storm surge in Florida. We'll talk more about that next week when we talk about hurricanes, due to the force of the winds moving water onshore. And it cost us probably about $3 billion. And in 1993, you were probably not even born because you're so young, but that was still a huge amount of money. And so these things are expensive and they have a huge influence. It really is what controls our weather. So we'd like to understand them. So here's a little review for you, because it's going to be important to understand what we do today. So we have these different types of fronts, which are these boundaries between air masses, okay? So we have our cold front. These move relatively fast. We get this quite abrupt line of clouds and rainfall because they form a fairly steep line in the atmosphere between the cold air on one side and the warm air on the other. And as that cold air moves in, that warm air is forced upwards. So it cools, condenses, and forms clouds. We have our warm fronts. These move much slower because as that warm air tries to move in and replace the cold air on the other side, it doesn't really force it out. It ends up itself being forced up and over. So it's much slower to displace air from a region. And as that air is forced up and over, it forms this quite shallow boundary in the atmosphere. And so that air is sort of rising relatively slowly and steadily. And so we get pretty thick areas of cloud. We also get rainfall that's forming in that warm air and falling through the cold air that's close to the surface. So this is the conditions that we need to set up things like sort of freezing rain or sleet or even snow. Stationary fronts are our most boring front. They are pretty stationary. We have warm air on one side, cold air on the other. It's not really going anywhere. And then we have our occluded front, the slightly more tricky one, where we have a cold front catching up with a warm front. And as it does that, that warm air is forced up. And then we just have that cold and cool air coming together. And then lastly, we have our dry line. There's no change in temperature here as that dry line moves across. But what we do see is a huge change in the humidity. Okay. And so I wanted to go through again the development of an occluded front, because this was a bit more of a challenging idea, more or less the only challenging idea on Tuesday. So if our cold front is moving faster, then over time it can catch up with a warm front ahead of itself. And as it catches up, that cold air that's on one side of that cold front will end up sliding underneath the warm air, and then finally, even underneath the cooler air on the far side of the warm front. That warm air doesn't just disappear into nowhere, it doesn't vanish. That warm air is still there, but we wouldn't experience it at the surface. That warm air instead is being forced up in the middle as those two cooler air masses sort of collide and come together. And so it's still being lifted, and so we still get that air rising, expanding, cooling, and forming clouds and rainfall. Okay. So, let's talk about something new. Let's talk about mid-latitude cyclones. So these are enormous, huge systems. They're very important for our weather. And they form along the polar front. Okay. So we just talked about all those other different types of fronts. But remember, our polar front is that boundary between where the feral cell and the polar cell meet. And we'll come back to that in a second. These sort of mid-latitude cyclones start forming along this particular boundary, okay? And they do tend to last quite a while once they form. It takes time for them to sort of develop and become mature cyclones, and then it takes time for them to die away again. So they tend to last a week or so, which is why if they move in off the Pacific, they don't just affect us, but they affect other people to the east of us as well. So we'll look at the life history. So, the clue is in the name. We talked about mid-latitudes between the tropics and the poles. So that's our mid-latitudes. But these are also cyclones. And I want to remind you way, way, way back now, I think in week three even, we looked at this sort of diagram where we were mostly at that point concentrating on understanding which way the winds actually move around these different systems. But do you remember, we also defined anything that is a high pressure system. It doesn't matter if it's in the northern hemisphere or the southern hemisphere, doesn't matter which way the winds are going. If that center is a high pressure, we call it anticyclonic. Okay? And then if we have low pressure in the center, doesn't matter if it's the northern or the southern hemisphere, we call it a cyclonic flow. So when we talk about cyclones, whether those are tropical cyclones or hurricanes, those are low-pressure systems. When we talk about mid-latitude cyclones, these are low-pressure systems. And low-pressure systems is where all of the interesting stuff happens, because that's where we have air moving together. That's where we have different air masses coming together, and we see lots of stuff happening in our atmosphere. So remember, cyclonic flow, cyclones are low-pressure systems. So here's our little polar front, pulling together lots of stuff today from various other lectures. And so you can see that, remember, here is our polar front, and we call it the polar front because there's a really, really sharp change in temperature between the feral cell to the south, where we have surface winds moving north, and so these are nice warm winds meeting this really cold air that's moving from the pole southwards. And so we see a really strong temperature contrast here, and we call that our polar front. And in particular, above that polar front, because we have that really strong temperature difference, we also have a really strong pressure difference. Okay? So we have a really strong pressure difference up here, high in the atmosphere. So what forms? The jet streams, absolutely. And they tend to move in this direction. So westerly, so from the west to the east around the Earth, both in the northern hemisphere and also in the southern hemisphere. And I'll say that for today, just to make our life a lot easier, we're really just going to concentrate on what happens in the northern hemisphere. So how these mid-latitude cyclones develop in the northern hemisphere and then how they move across the US. We're not going to complicate ourselves by thinking about the southern hemisphere at all. So how do these things get started? So there was a Norwegian guy called Bjerknes, great name, in the around 1914-1918, which is where the front comes from. Everyone was fighting in the war, and so they had the battle fronts, and he sort of pictured the atmosphere as these battles between different air masses. Quick aside. Anyway, he came up with this polar front theory to explain some of these patterns. Because we started to observe these things, and he sort of actually described what was going on. Because, I mean, we take for granted that we can observe these things moving through time. For a long time, people didn't really think that that weather shifted latitude. They didn't think it came in from the sea and moved out to the west. They just thought that they sort of developed and died in the same place, whereas we know better now, they move. So here's his idea for how we form these mid-latitude cyclones, and we call that cyclogenesis, the birth of our cyclones. So we start off at the polar front. And if you remember, if we go back, we have our easterly winds coming down from the Arctic, this cold air moving down from the Arctic, and it sort of forms these easterly winds. It's being deflected to the right as it moves from high to low, meeting these westerly winds that are part of the feral cell to the south, and that's warmer air. And so that's what our top diagram is showing us. We have that cold air coming down in the polar cell up here and being diverted this way, and then we have our warm air as part of the feral cell coming up this way and being deflected in that direction. So we have cold air moving past warm air, and we have a stationary front between those two. Okay? But if we can develop a little wobble or a little kink in that stationary front, then what ends up happening is that now we have this colder air that's starting to move sort of southwards. It's starting to rotate around, and as it rotates around, it moves into warm air. And so what that does is it basically becomes a cold front. We have cold air moving, sort of circulating around and trying to move into warm air. And on the other side of our sort of little bend or sort of wobble in the polar front, we have warm air that is moving north. It's sort of curling around to the north. And so in this area, we have warm air moving into cold air, and we develop a warm front. So what we're doing is we're taking that polar front with cold air to the north, warm air to the south, and we're bending it, okay? And as we bend it, we're moving one air mass into the next. And so by the time we get to the end picture there, the bottom right-hand side, we've developed a mature cyclone. It consists of both the sort of V shape, one side is a cold front, one side is a warm front. So here's our mature cyclone. This is a fully developed mid-latitude cyclone. And so you can see that along that cold front, we have this relatively narrow band of clouds. The percentages there give you what percentage likelihood it is that you're going to have rainfall, precipitation in that particular area. Okay? And so you can see that as we get towards that low in the very middle, because remember we have this flow coming around this center and it's cyclonic, so if we have a low in the center, then we get more and more likelihood of rain. Okay, and that's because we have lifting by convergence in that very central point, and then we have frontal lifting along these fronts. And then on the other side of our warm front, do you remember we have a much shallower boundary in our atmosphere, so we have this thicker band of potential rainfall and clouds. Okay? So, tell me, where would you find the warmest air on my diagram? A, B, C, or D? So take a second to find where those letters are. Consult your neighbor. Where would you find the warmest air on my diagram? So we don't quite agree yet. So guess what I'm going to do? Turn to your neighbor, explain your answer, justify yourself. I think that's more or less everyone who voted before. So let's see if we agree. So there's not really that much of a shift, and if anything, it shifted the wrong way. Okay. So for those of you that voted B, well done. You didn't follow the crowd, and you were right. So I can see definitely one person who voted B at the back there. He's celebrating. Okay. So let's think about why that's the case. If most of us are getting that wrong, then we need to think about what's happening. So, with my cold front, if we just look at my cold front there, which side is the cold air? Is it A or D? So A is the cold air. So we have this cold air where that front is moving into warm air. Okay? With our warm front, where is the warm air? Is it B or C? It's B, right? Because we have warm air moving into cold air. So we have that warm air. So really that warm air, is it B? So D, maybe, but it's sort of certainly cloud covered there. And so B is our safest bet for where that warm air is. And the other way of thinking about this is, do you remember we had our polar front? We had the cold air along the top. We had the warm air along the bottom. If we're folding it, where does that warm air end up? In the middle of that V, okay? So it goes from like that, cold air, and that cold air basically is now surrounding all the way around, and that warm air is really stuck in the center. Does that make sense now? For those people that didn't quite get it? Okay, draw yourself a couple of diagrams. So tell me, see if we can do better this time round. Where would you find the longest lived precipitation, perhaps even including sleet or freezing rain? So think back to your fronts again. Think about what is associated with each front. What is the air going to be like at the surface on either side of those fronts, which is going to be more likely to lead to sleet and freezing rain? And then tell me when you think you've decided. So let's take a look and see if we agree this time around. Oh, we at least get over 50%, and it's even the right answer, so that's a good sign. So yes, at C. So let's think about what's happening across that warm front. Do you remember we said that that boundary is much shallower? So we're going to have more extensive cloud, sort of more potential for there to be longer lived rainfall. With the cold front, that cold air pushes that warm up really quite steeply. We get rainfall in that particular zone, and then it's moved past. With our warm front, we have this sort of shallow boundary where we have clouds and rainfall for much longer. And also, what's sort of the temperature at the ground surface? It's cold, right? We have this warm air rising above cold air. And so if we have precipitation and moisture and sort of droplets of ice or water falling through that cold air, then it has the potential to form our freezing rain or our sleet, which, you remember, had to have that cold air, that layer of cold air close to the ground in order to refreeze some of that moisture. Okay, so this is our mature cyclone, and you can see these every day, more or less, across the US. Today might be an exception because we have this gigantic high pressure system over much of the US, but usually they're around. Okay, so once we form our mid-latitudes, they exist for a while, but remember that our cold front is moving much faster than our warm front. And so it's going to die. And we call this process where it sort of fades away, this occlusion process, where that warm front, we've already thought about this on Tuesday, that cold front catches up with that warm front, it's moving much faster, and it basically zips up. Okay, it sort of zips up the middle. And so in those places where we have that occluded front, now we have cold air directly meeting cooler air at the surface, and that warm air is pushed right up. Instead of being stuck in that central sort of part of the cyclone, now it's actually been pushed up above these two other air masses. And so through time, you can see that more and more and more of that front becomes occluded until it's no longer there anymore. And so this is the story of our polar front. This is the polar front theory. And Bjerknes had it absolutely right. He had the right idea, and he described it perfectly. What he couldn't explain is why they form to begin with, why they strengthen, and why they die out. Yes, those fronts catch up, but why does that happen at the time it happens and everything else? And that's because he didn't know about upper level winds. So before we talk about upper level winds, I have a challenge for you. So here's that same image I showed you, which has the fronts for Tuesday of next week. And so I want you to spend some time looking at this and work out how many of our mid-latitude cyclones at any sort of particular stage can you identify on the map, okay? So consult your neighbor. How many mid-latitude cyclones, either mature or partly occluded, can you identify on here? So. Okay, let's take a look and see how many people could find. So a few people gave up a few too soon. I would agree with C, but I'm willing to be argued with for anyone that voted D. So let's see. So point me out a mid-latitude cyclone. All the arms go in different directions. Okay. So I'll point you out the ones that I saw that were nice and obvious, and then if you voted four, tell me which one I'm missing. So I'm quite willing to be argued with. So here's one. You can see a cold front, warm front, partly occluded front. Yep. Here's one. We have cold front, warm front, partly occluded front. Here's one. Cold front, warm front, partly occluded front. So did someone spot a fourth? Are you willing? Whereabouts?
The west coast.
The west coast. Down here?
Up.
Up here? Maybe, but where's the warm front? So it might be in the process of dying. So it might be really very much older. Is that the one you're talking about up here? Yeah? So anyway, I would take both answers if you want to argue with me. But you can get the idea that these things are really common. I mean, this is just Tuesday. I picked it pretty much at random. Okay, it looked nice. And so you can see that really these things are constantly moving across the US. And they're really the main driver of a lot of the weather that we see. So the challenge that Bjerknes had was that he was doing this in 1914 to 1918. He didn't really know very much about the upper atmosphere. Again, we take so much for granted. We assume that we've always known. But we really didn't know much about the upper atmosphere. In particular, we didn't know that there were these very, very fast upper tropospheric winds that were circulating around. It was really the fighter pilots in World War II, once they were going up high in the atmosphere, they were the ones that realized they suddenly got places much, much faster than they should have done. They're like, oh, what happened? Then got into the jet stream, okay. So let's think about what is happening with our upper tropospheric winds. So we're gonna come back to our favorite thing, which is Rossby waves, okay? So remember, we talked about the polar front, this boundary between the feral cell and the polar cell, where this really sharp change in temperature happens. And so we see this really sharp change high up in the atmosphere in pressure, and that's where our jet stream forms. And if we were just to assume that it's a fairly simple idea, that if we assume that's just the way it is, then our winds should circulate more or less like this. The jet stream will go around in a westerly direction, so from west to east, just sort of at the same latitude, okay? But we know that actually little wobbles, little instabilities can develop in that position of the polar front and in the polar jet stream itself. And so now we have, you can see that sort of warm air moving north, cold air coming south, and that wind is moving not just around one constant latitude, it's now also moving north-south. And then as that Rossby wave gets even more sort of extreme, then now you can see that we have really, really strong north-south movement. And it's that change between being at a constant latitude to being moving north-south that is what drives the development of the highs and lows that we see at the surface. Okay, so we're going to talk more about why that's the case. So, controls on mid-latitude weather. Well, first of all, just because we have that difference in temperature between the equator and the poles, we get sort of variations in our weather. But also, we have to remember that the Earth is rotating still. Unfortunately for us, it adds confusion to everything, but the Earth is rotating. We can't ignore that. And so we're going to talk today about vorticity, which is a great name, and it's a terrifying name to anyone who doesn't know what it means, okay? So if you take your coffee in a cup and you swirl it a little bit, then it ends up moving, right? It ends up moving in a circle. It's basically rotating around a vertical axis, okay, if you've just sort of moved your cup like that. And so your coffee will have vorticity. And so any fluid can have vorticity. And remember, a fluid can be gas, like the atmosphere, or it can be also water, a liquid, okay? So we all have a component of vorticity, and that's because the Earth is spinning. If you are on the Earth, you have a component of planetary vorticity. And we know this because we've talked about the Coriolis effect, okay? So, does anyone remember where the Coriolis effect is the most? Is it at the poles or the equator? At the poles. And you can see that really nicely in my diagram here. You can see why vorticity is also maximum at the poles. So if you imagine that clock tower, I'm not quite sure why they drew a clock tower, but they did, on the top of the pole there, in order for it to get into the same position 24 hours later, it basically does that, okay? It rotates around this vertical axis. If we go to the equator, is that clock spinning? No, it's just traveling around. It doesn't have a component of rotation, okay? And so it has zero planetary vorticity. Okay, so this is a really important thing. Remember that planetary vorticity is the maximum at the poles and zero at the equator. Is everyone clear on that bit? Yes? So, in addition to planetary vorticity, we can have relative vorticity. So, I am stood here. Even if I don't move, I have a component of planetary vorticity because I'm not stood at the equator. We're at 33, 35, whatever degree latitude we are. And so I have a certain amount of planetary vorticity. Does that make sense? Now I have relative vorticity. Okay? I could have relative vorticity the other way now as well. Okay? So in that, at that moment, I have both a component of planetary vorticity, but I am also spinning relative to the Earth. Does that make sense? Yes? Okay. So, I learned a very clever trick from one of my TAs last year, who is a very smart meteorologist. And he showed me how to work out whether you have positive vorticity or negative vorticity. So when we have lows and when we have highs, we end up with sort of rotational movement relative to the Earth. And so when we see that movement of air, we have a certain component of relative vorticity. Okay, so we have an absolute vorticity. And that absolute vorticity is the planetary vorticity plus your relative vorticity. Okay, so absolute equals planetary plus relative. And there's one absolutely key thing that you have to remember to understand the rest today, which is absolute vorticity is conserved, which means that your value of absolute vorticity doesn't change. Okay? You start out with, I don't know, 3, you have to keep that. Okay? And what that means is that, therefore, if I change planetary vorticity, if we want the absolute to stay the same, we're also going to have to change the relative. Does that make sense? Yes? Stunned silence? Okay. So, let's think about how we can change our planetary vorticity. Okay? And we just said that we have a different amount of planetary vorticity between the poles and the equator. So if you look at the left-hand diagram on my slide here, so if the winds are moving from the North Pole towards the equator, so they're moving southwards, is the wind gaining or losing planetary vorticity? So think for a minute, consult your neighbor, and then I'll take a vote. Okay, let's take a look. ...70% of people are with me. Couldn't get above 70 last time either. So we would be losing because where is it the maximum? Poles, minimum at the equator. So if I'm going from north to south, I'm going to be losing planetary vorticity. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yes. So remember that my absolute vorticity, though, has to stay the same. So if I'm losing planetary vorticity, what has to happen to my relative vorticity? Okay, so if we imagine that that wind is moving from the pole to the equator, it's losing planetary vorticity, what is going to happen to my relative vorticity? Okay, last couple of seconds. Yeah. Why we lose it? Yeah, do you remember, let me just close this and look at the answer and then I'll come back to it if that's okay. Okay, so 78%, I'm winning, getting there, okay? So yes, so let's go back for my friend's question up there. Way back. Okay, so do you remember up at the pole, if I have my clock tower, in order for it to get back to the same position in that 24 hours, it basically has to rotate. It has to spin around that vertical axis which the Earth is rotating around. If you imagine that same clock tower, if you imagine that is my clock tower and it travels around the Earth, it's not actually spinning relative to my axis of rotation of the Earth. Up here, it rotates. If it's at the equator, it just travels around. Does that make sense? So it's maximum up at the poles, zero at the equator, like the same as the Coriolis force. Does that help? Great. Okay. So, we got to the right answer for the majority of people, which is a good news, which is that if my winds are coming from north to south in the northern hemisphere, if they're moving towards the equator, I'm losing planetary vorticity. If my absolute has to stay the same, I have to gain relative vorticity. Okay? So that's a relatively simple idea. And this is where my TA last year's wonderful idea comes in. So hold out your right hand. Thank you. Hello. Okay, so now I want you to look at the image on my on the right-hand side there, and I want you with your four fingers to make that shape, okay? So point your fingers in the direction that that wind is moving, okay? Imagine that you're on the piece of paper, okay? And it's not working at all, okay. Imagine that the slide is on the table in front of you, okay? Put your fingers, line up your four fingers along the direction of motion. So your fingers point along the direction of motion. Where does your thumb go? Up. Positive. Okay, we have positive relative vorticity, okay? Now imagine if you're at position two, okay? Now point your fingers in the direction of motion. Which way does it point? Ah. Okay, have we more or less got this now? Yes? So remember, right hand, if it's positive, that's sort of the way that the motion is going. That's the way it's sort of rotating around that relative vorticity. Okay, so now we have to think about what is going on. So what we have is that we have to somehow gain vorticity, okay? In order to make it around this curve, we're gaining vorticity, okay? And so I want to sort of get you to think a little bit about what is happening in the upper atmosphere. So we're going to review, again, going way back. And last time we looked at this image, we were basically looking at it from the surface and saying, okay, if we have a high at the surface, that means that winds are going out in all directions, and that means that air is sinking in the middle, okay? And then we said that the air is compressing and warming, and so we have lovely clear skies where we have high pressure. We said, okay, if we have a low at the surface, that means that air is going out in all directions, okay? And if it's going out in all directions, we can't sort of have a vacuum left in the middle. We're going to pull down air from up above, okay? And that is, oh, sorry. Hang on, I said that completely wrong, didn't I? I'm sorry. If we have a low, you should wave at me and tell me. So when we have a low, we have air moving in, okay? We keep piling that air in, and so it's going to be forced to rise. Okay. So what we didn't talk about, though, was what's happening up above. You may have looked at it and gone, okay, and tried to memorize it for the midterm, but we didn't really go about explaining it. And there's a reason behind that, because we hadn't talked about jet streams yet, we hadn't talked about upper-level winds, and so it wouldn't have made much sense. But you can see that up above, all of those arrows, all of that wind is going in one direction. That's basically our upper level, our westerly winds, the sort of like where our jet stream is going. Okay, it's all going in one direction. But you can see that at highs, above highs, we have convergence. So we're forcing air together high up in the atmosphere, and if we're forcing air high up in the atmosphere together, we're sort of making a high pressure, really, and that air is then forced down until it hits the surface, and it creates a high at the surface. Does that make sense? So if we have convergence up above, we're forcing more air together, and some of that air is going to, it doesn't like being forced together, we create a relative high. That forces air downwards, and it bumps against the surface, and we create a high at the surface. Does that make sense? Maybe. Let's think about it for the low pressure. If we have divergence happening in the atmosphere, it's almost like it'll basically suck air up We're diverging, we're sort of basically making a lower pressure, we're having less air molecules in the same space, that's going to pull air up from underneath. And if we're pulling air up from underneath, we're also going to have less air molecules at the surface, we're going to have low pressure there. So really it's this convergence and divergence up high in the atmosphere which is creating our highs and lows at the surface. Yes or no? No? Okay. Let me think. So I'm trying to find a different way of explaining it. So converging, you know what converging means? Everything's piling together. We're going to pile together lots of air molecules. That those winds in the upper atmosphere are coming together, that means the air molecules are coming together. And if we're piling up lots of air molecules, we create a relative high pressure. And that relative high pressure is going to try and force air away. And it's a bit like we thought about with upwelling and downwelling. We can't necessarily force it up terribly easily. We're pretty high up in the atmosphere. We can't force it out to the sides because we're converging at the sides. The only place it can really go is down. And it goes down, all of those air, that wind is forced down until it hits the surface. And we're forcing more air molecules down to the surface, and so we're creating a relative high. Does that make sense? Hopefully? Okay. And if we're creating a high at the surface, we have air moving outwards in all directions. With our low, our winds are moving apart. So all of our air molecules are moving apart. If we're taking away air molecules, we're going to have less pressure left behind. We're creating a low. And we're not going to just sort of get rid of all of our air molecules and just go, okay, that's it. We need to replace those air molecules with something. We can't necessarily do it from up above. We're really high in the atmosphere. There aren't very many molecules up above. What we're going to have to do is pull air up from underneath. Okay? So we're going to pull that air up from underneath. And if we're removing air molecules from the surface to replace the stuff up the high up, then we're going to leave behind a lower pressure at the surface. Okay. More with me this time around? Yes? Okay. So let's think about why we get this convergence and divergence. Okay. So here's our world record skating person. Watch what happens as she pulls her arms in. Okay? And then as she opens up again, it closes up. Okay? So it's the same thing that ice skaters do, and it's to do with conservation of angular momentum. So if you have parts of you, if you have mass that's a long way from the axis of rotation where you're spinning, then you have to conserve that angular momentum as you change that distance that your sort of limbs are from the axis of rotation. You can speed up and slow down. Okay? And this is what is more or less happening with the air up in our atmosphere. Okay? So if we think about what's happening as we go from sort of 1 to 9 along my little Rossby wave, so you can imagine that that is the path of our upper tropospheric winds. We have air moving in that path from 1 to 9. And as it does that, it's going to set up a high and a low pressure system. So from 1 to 3, we're traveling in a straight line, okay? If you're traveling in a straight line, you don't have relative vorticity, okay? If you have a component of relative vorticity, you're just going to keep going round and round and round, okay? By the time we get to sort of 3 and 4, remember we're moving north-south, we're moving closer to the equator, we're losing planetary vorticity. In order for our absolute vorticity to stay the same, we need to gain relative vorticity. And in particular, we need more positive relative vorticity. Thumbs up. We need to go sort of that way round. Okay? And so in order to do that, in order to gain positive vorticity, what did he do to speed up? Did he do that or did he do that? He converged. Okay? So in order to gain relative vorticity, you need to converge. And so that's what the winds are doing up high in the atmosphere. So at that point, from 3 to 4, We're converging, we're piling air molecules together, and that means that those air molecules piled together at the surface are going to be forced towards the ground, and as all of that air is forced towards the ground, we develop a high pressure at the ground. Does that make sense? Yes? Good. Okay. Now let's think what happens as we come out, as we sort of, we have this constant amount of relative vorticity. If we have a constant amount of relative vorticity, we're basically just going around in a circle. Okay? So in order to stop ourselves going around in a complete circle, from 6 to 7, what do we have to do? We have to lose vorticity. So what did he do to lose vorticity? Did he compress or sort of diverge? He diverged, okay? So, and that's what's going to happen from 6 to 7. In order to lose that component of vorticity, you have to diverge. And at that point, we're sort of moving all of those air molecules far apart. If we're moving all of those air molecules far apart, we create a low up high in the atmosphere, and that is going to pull up air from underneath, and that's removing air from the surface, so we're going to create a low at the surface. Is everyone with me, or do you want me to go through it one more time? One more time? Very happy to do that. So if you imagine we're going from 1 to 3, okay? Going in a straight line, we don't have a sort of component, or we have a constant amount of relative vorticity at that point, or zero relative vorticity. As we get to so between 3 and 4, okay, we're sort of bending round, okay? We're gaining relative vorticity, okay? And in particular, we're gaining positive relative vorticity, okay? And so in order to do that, in order to gain that spin, in order to sort of gain that spin, what my friend there did was he converged. If you pull everything in, then you're going to sort of end up with a higher amount of relative vorticity, okay? And so up high, what's happening is that all of the winds there are converging. And if we're pulling, so all of those air molecules are coming together, we're creating a high pressure, basically. We're creating an area where there's lots of molecules, we have higher pressure, and that is going to force air outwards, okay? It can't go out sideways because we're converging, so it goes down towards the surface. We're forcing more air down towards the surface, we also end up with a high pressure down at my surface. If we think then about what happens next, we have this now certain amount of relative vorticity, and we're basically going round in a circle. And in order to avoid going round in a complete circle and just sort of circling there forever, we need to lose a certain amount of that vorticity. Okay? We need to sort of decrease that vorticity. And so what we saw is that in order to lose some of that spin, in order to lose some of that rotation, if you diverge, that's sort of what happens, okay? You lose some of that vorticity as you diverge. And so on that side, from 6 to 7, in order to go from going around in a circle to basically going straight again, you have to lose that vorticity. We see divergence, the wind is moving apart, the air molecules are moving apart, and we create a relative low high up in the atmosphere. That relative low pulls air in to replace the air molecules that are moving away. And that creates a relative low down at the surface. Okay? And so air is sort of being drawn upwards to replace it. Okay? So that's how we get our surface highs and our surface lows. And we see them on either side of our bends in our Rossby waves. So they can be very important for strengthening our sort of mid-latitude cyclones, sort of deepening that low pressure as we get divergence up above. It sort of pulls more air up, and so we get stronger air moving into the middle. Yes?
When you're moving from 1 to 3 or 7 to 9, mm-hmm. Does that do something to planetary vorticity?
So yes, planetary vorticity is changing. So in my diagram here, it's a bit fudged, but yeah. Okay. So let's have a look at what that looks like. This is sort of a schematic of what would be. And so you can see that these Rossby waves are really big features. They're not little wobbles. They're really big features that can occupy a lot of the US sort of in the atmosphere. And so you can see that as we move towards our sort of our central bit here, let me point at it with the mouse. So basically what we're doing is we're looking in this section just like we were before. So on this side, what we have is convergence going on. Okay, you can see those winds are coming together. That creates higher pressure here, that forces air down, and creates a high down here, the surface, and winds end up moving out. And remember that as that air is being forced downwards, it's, as it's sinking, it's warming because it's compressing, and so we get clear skies. On the other side, you can see that we have this divergence going on, okay? And so up here, we're basically sort of creating a little area of low, and that pulls air up to replace that diverging air, and that creates a low pressure at the surface, and the winds are moving into that low, and that's why we see air masses moving together into that low, okay? And this also starts to explain why our weather patterns go from the west to the east, because these are basically traveling with the jet stream that's traveling with those overlying sort of upper level winds. Okay, so I want you to imagine here, this is taken from a long time ago, but I can't find another good example. So this shows the jet stream path for 2010 or so in May, okay? So my challenge for you is to try and put together some of what we've done. So this is gonna take, I don't know, maybe 3-4 minutes, okay, to really think through and see if you can reason through the steps. Where are we going to get a high pressure? So think about where air will be converging in the upper atmosphere, where air will be diverging, what that means in terms of where you'll get a high or a low at the surface. So A, B, or C, and the TAs can wander around as well if they want and help you out, okay? So vote A, B, or C for which you think is going to be where the high pressure area will form at the surface, okay? High pressure at the surface. Okay, any last answers for me, or has everyone had a chance to vote? Okay, let's take a look and see what you thought. So, there's a majority, 67%, you would be right, okay? So if we take a look, okay, we have lows in these other locations at A and C. And if you look at the weather map that day, that's what we saw, okay? We saw these two lows on either side of the country and a central high pressure, okay? So you're doing very well. So now for the people that aren't so certain, I think it's worth taking a quick look. And if you guessed, then it's also a good time to listen. So, if we think about what's happening, if we think about the winds traveling along this yellow path of our jet stream, okay, then as we get to A, if we keep the same component of relative vorticity, basically what would happen is we'd just keep going round and round in a circle, okay? We have the same amount of relative vorticity, we just keep going round. So what do we have to do at A? We have to lose some relative vorticity. How do we lose vorticity? Okay? Yep. So he diverged. So we have divergence happening up high at A, okay? And you can imagine the same thing is true at C, okay? At C, if we kept the same component of relative vorticity, we'd keep going round and round in a circle. Whereas at C, we have to lose some of that vorticity in order to go in a straight line, okay? And so at both of those locations, we have divergence happening high up in the atmosphere, and that, remember, creates a low, and that pulls air up from underneath and creates a surface low below. At B, if we think about what's happening, at B, we have the, sort of the air moving down in this direction, and it's traveling sort of relatively straight here, and in order to make it around the bend, it needs to gain an additional component of relative vorticity, okay? So at B, it's trying to gain vorticity in order to sort of bend around. And so what did he do to speed up? He converged, okay? And so when we do that, we create more molecules in that same space. We create high, up high in the atmosphere, and that forces air downwards, and it sort of reaches the surface and creates a surface high as well, okay? Does that make a certain amount of sense to people? It's a challenge. This one, I think, is the most challenging lecture of the quarter. It's all downhill from here on in. Well, not downhill. It's all interesting stuff. But it gets remarkably easier, I think, after this. Okay. So you can see that, really, this sort of the polar jet stream and the Rossby waves in particular are really the ultimate driver behind some of these highs and lows that develop. Not all of them, but certainly some of these big ones. And so if we think about how that affects our mid-latitude cyclones, remember these are low-pressure systems. So if you imagine that we have this Rossby wave and it's sort of coming across the US, okay, and remember that this is forming above that polar front. Okay, it's above that polar front. And so here, especially if we start bending that polar front, if we are creating this sort of mid-latitude cyclone, then that divergence up high in the atmosphere is pulling air upwards. It's deepening that low pressure. Okay, if we're pulling more and more air upwards, we're getting lower and lower pressure at the surface, and that pulls those air masses together, and we get this rotation going on. We develop our mid-latitude system. And this is why they follow. This is why they move from sort of this side of the country, the west side, to the east, because they're following this jet stream. Okay? And you can see that this is the other reason why they sort of end up dying out. They don't sort of exist forever. And that's because as it keeps moving around, then eventually it reaches a point, say down here. This is my original position. It's following the jet stream round. It reaches a point over here where now we have convergence happening. Okay, we have convergence happening in the upper atmosphere. And so what does that do? It forces air together. We create the high up high in the atmosphere. That forces air downwards. It's basically filling in our low. We're not sucking air out from the middle anymore. We're not forcing it to rise. We're actually forcing air downwards. And that's going to reduce the strength of our low pressure. Does that make sense? Yeah? And so this is why these things sort of die out. It's because that movement of the system to a location where instead of divergence, we get this convergence. And this is what Bjerknes didn't know when he was creating his polar front model. He could describe it really well, but he couldn't explain why these things were happening. And so this is why that's happening. So that's all. There is no homework three, don't panic. But lightning, thunderstorms, and tornadoes on Tuesday. Thanks, guys.